the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out.
Thank you.
Sometimes, and especially around here, people are so possessive with their land as a dog is with hydrants. It was mission accomplished with the wicked nectar in his hands.
Cherche où trouve, parce que je t'aime bien, Astor, je vais te dire quelque chose. Tu fais bien de prendre ma pelisse, parce que par là-bas, tu vas rencontrer le vrai froid. Un froid qui glace comme t'en as jamais connu dans ta vie. C'est encore beau. Tout ce qui est vieilli est bien meilleur.
The old man's cabin had been very generous to him. He couldn't have asked for more. Luckily, he had the coat to protect him from the biting cold. Seems like the elements showed mercy to those nice and solid-looking planks. Another instance of this magic ice. What was this one doing, lying on the ground, so afraid? The plot thickened like water into ice. He had been running in fear from something creeping towards him, against which he couldn't do anything, only to end up like this, petrified and cold. It seemed as though Regin had been ready to take up arms and slay people like Hamilton. Could he have committed murder for his cause? Who could have gotten killed in front of his very eyes? Seemed to take over this place like mold. That wall wasn't there earlier. How was he going to get out of here? The ice, oddly, did not budge despite the powerful fiery blast. Something was definitely rotten in this place. Suddenly felt observed. He was worried about a presence around him. No stone can withstand the force of dynamite. Thank you. Carl felt a chill down his spine and had a terrifying realization. If Hamilton was dead, then who was going to pay him? Carl was beginning to know the store and its surroundings like the back of his hand. The Seeker had sought.
Thank you. Thank you.
phantom disappeared in the wilderness. Carl had seen what happened to it too. Numbness was giving way to awareness. The vision was wavering. Be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. The punishing cold rendered the door frozen tight. Carl saw no way to open it.
Thank you.
becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. Shit. What could it be? The air was freezing, right down to the bone. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. Something was hidden under the stairs. The man grabbed his rifle. Carl felt a sense of dread in him. Perhaps their spousal relationship had been cooling down lately. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. The vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which Giselle, Jill's loving spouse, was motionless, frozen in ice. Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double-layered security system blending letters and numbers. Its code couldn't be broken by the common burglar. Ah, moving. What a pleasant activity. Of course, you'll find the record player only to find the records weeks later in some random box. The general store, along with several more infrastructures in the area, had been acquired by wealthy industrialist William J. Hamilton. Perhaps the village should be rechristened Hamiltown. A mess. Clearly, there was some major revamping work underway here. The place looked barely habitable. Thank you. looks like the holes in that puzzle are there to stay. Shiver ran down Carl's spine as he glanced over another body trapped in ice. Indeed, the scene was quite chilling. Carl felt familiar shivers going down his spine, and he was back to the realm of visions. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. Vision slowly faded away, like an icicle melting in the palm of your hand. Carl, back in the real world, now knew who the icebound man was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. third phantom gently faded away. Carl noticed that as the cursed villagers finally left reality, he could feel a sense of unburdening exuding from them in an almost intimate way. The last phantom, lost in solitude up until now, joined the others in the forest's darkness, free at last to enjoy an eternal, well-deserved slumber. Carl was only beginning to understand the horror which had struck his village. He understood that the dead were piling up and that he couldn't help them by himself. The road was clear for him. He needed to push further north and fast to find help. For the one-eyed, or for other vision problems, the eye patch was the way to go. There was no doubt that the doctor and Hamilton knew each other very well. The good doctor, flanked by his beautiful spouse. Pure happiness, captured on cardstock. Carl recognized this woman's soulful eye. was it Dr. Beaupré who had hit him head-on at the village border? Nobody kills a rich patient to start a revolution. It didn't make any sense. He had to dig deeper still to understand. Luckily, that was Carl Faubert's specialty. Felt like he knew the doctor now. His belongings had spoken lengths about him. But what Carl had heard worried him. Another diary. Carl felt like someone was trying to communicate with him. Or was it simply the result of happenstance? Right until that point, Carl had believed that the object of this crossbow hunting had been a ravenous wolf who was terrorizing the village. But as he noticed the height at which the bolts had been fired, he concluded that the beast had to have been as tall as a man on his feet, not unlike a gorilla. The thought was chilling. Carl had found what he was looking for. He needed to get back on the road. Thank you. Carl reckoned that the place was still inhabited less than 24 hours ago. His detective sense tingled, revealing to him, or was it the strong smell of wilderness in the air, that there were most likely two men, two blankets. There were doubtless two people here, Carl reckoned. The jacket was still soaking wet. The poor man had, surely unwillingly, had a taste of the pond's water not too long ago. According to the pay stub, that poor man was Alexandre Blais. The door was unlocked. Carl felt kind of disappointed that he wouldn't have to solve the mystery of that padlock. Seems like the elements showed mercy to those nice and solid-looking planks. The door had been busted down violently, and a burnt smell filled the air. Half of the cabin had been consumed by flames. Carl surveyed the chaotic scene, noticing that someone appeared to have intended to use the furniture as bonfire fuel. Carl had no idea how such a mess could have occurred, but he knew it didn't bode well. Thank you. This hunt was never ending. Carl hoped that the hunter had finally triumphed over the beast. Seems like this place was long deserted. Two more victims of this ice plague. Carl felt a chill down his spine. What if he was next? Carl felt the strong pull of a vision overcome him. It looked like a simple hunting accident. There was Hamilton. Carl recognized him. A major hunting accident. The doctor examined the young woman. death couldn't be overturned. She was dead. Was not the type of body you buried in a big ceremony in the village graveyard. It had to be hidden. No one could know about this. The best way to do that was to have a simple-minded man bury the poor girl, Lamotte, the mechanic. Doctor denied the unfair death of the young woman, but Hamilton had him in his grips. Hamilton knew all of the poet's secrets and wouldn't hesitate to reveal them. I know all about your crimes, you little communist. You know mine. What a sordid affair. Understood the ins and outs of the affair. A woman had been killed in an unfair accident, and a young warrior had damned himself to avenge her. But Hamilton, the one responsible, had already been killed, and so the beast could not quench his thirst for vengeance. And now, recklessly, Carl had pulled the bolt from the beast's heart. A beast who was but a young free man lost without his fiancée, and who had, out of hatred, become Wendigo. Thank you. sheltered him. But for how long? Disappeared, so did Purity. I would defend Purity against the winds, the tides, against ice and blizzard. Could it be that all this was but a story of justice and vengeance? The soulful doctor, avenging his fiancée's unjust death by avenging this young woman as though she was his lover. Are these passionate feelings not precisely the kind of feelings that could cause a storm, petrify people deep inside?